Village Green English. Everyday British English, British English every day. You're listening to the Curiosity Contest. I am Nathan, and with me is Tom. We are English teachers and the two founders of Village Green English. Every week, we are recording a podcast to find out which word of the week is better. I will argue for my word of the week, and likewise, Tom will argue for his word of the week. Ultimately, this is a matter of opinion, and the winner will be decided by your vote in the poll.
The rules.
So, Tom, what are the rules?
Well, Nathan, I'm glad you asked. Every week, we choose a word pertaining to a topic which will be the subject of contentious debate in the podcast. The reward? A spot in the Virtual Village Museum of Lexical Curiosity. A thing must be chosen in relation to the word to symbolise the word and its journey through common language. The words and their representative artefacts will then be put forward to the community to cast their vote on their chosen victor.
My word of the week.
My word of the week is spy. Now, a spy is someone who spies on another person. So let's look at that word spy as a verb. So it means to watch stealthily, to observe, watch closely, find out, report, to scout or to look for. Now, Nathan, did you ever play the game I Spy as a child?
I still play it as an adult. It's a very good game. You can play it at any time, anywhere, with anyone. It's a great game.
Most English people have played the game I Spy. I'm sure the game exists in other countries around the world, but I remember as a kid on long car journeys playing endless games of I Spy with my brothers, but mostly arguing about what the rules were.
Mm-hmm. I Spy something beginning with R.
Is it a radio?
No, it's a red curry.
A red curry. Is it chicken tikka masala?
Yes.
Nice. So I chose this word this week because I find spies really interesting. And it links to one of my favourite words, espionage. And Britain is really famous for espionage and its spies. Now, a couple of weeks ago, you talked about Bletchley Park and the cracking of the Enigma code. That's right.
Yes, I did.
Yeah, and Britain has a history of very famous spies. Now, a couple of really famous British spies who are people you might not have realised were spies, but some famous writers such as Daniel Defoe and Roald Dahl, two of Britain's most famous writers. And a couple of more recent ones are John le Carré and Ian Fleming, both of which wrote about their experiences in the British intelligence service and fictionalized accounts and wrote stories about it. Now, have you heard of Ian Fleming?
Yes.
And that is?
Well, you asked me a yes-no question.
Sure.
Yeah, Ian Fleming is the author of the James Bond franchise.
Absolutely. And that brings me onto my artefact.
My artefact.
My artefact this week is, well, Nathan, James Bond is what we might say a British icon. But what is James often seen with, which is just as iconic?
A parachute while he's skiing?
There was that film. I can't remember which one. So my artefact this week is James Bond's Aston Martin DB5. So if you've ever watched a James Bond film, you might have seen this particular car in those films because it does crop up in a number of them. So the first James Bond film to feature the Aston Martin DB5 was Goldfinger back in 1964. So the DB5 that he drove in that was designed in 1963 by Aston Martin. And the Aston Martin DB5 is a British luxury grand tourer. And nowadays, the brand Aston Martin is pretty much one of Britain's most famous exports to the world. So the name comes from David Brown, who ran an engineering company, and he decided to buy Aston Martin back in 1947. Before that, Aston Martin had made some road cars and some race cars, both to varying degrees of success, and it had been in financial trouble a number of times before. After David Brown acquired the company, they made a few more cars, made a few more race cars, but it wasn't until 1964 when they managed to get their car into the film Goldfinger, where Aston Martin really became a well-known and iconic brand. So the company gave four cars over to E.ON, the company that was making the film, for filming and for publicity. Now, these cars, all after the film was sold, and each of them went for about £5 million each. So already they were extremely valuable items. So my specific artifact this week is actually one of those cars. It's the first one used of the two for filming. And this one was given over to special effects expert John Steers to give it the James Bond gadgets. Now, famously, James Bond likes to have gadgets in his cars. This particular one had machine guns that rose out of the bodywork. Now, bringing us back full circle to my word, spy, is that this story of my artifact ends in a little mystery. Did you know, Nathan, that in 1997, this particular DB5 was stolen from its owner in Florida and is currently still missing?
No comment.
Yeah, I wondered that. What that car under the cover in your garage is. Yeah. You never told me where you got your silver birch Aston Martin DB5 from.
Oh, the one with the guns?
Yeah, that one. Can I check the chassis number of it?
It still has a chassis number?
Is it DP/216/1?
It was sand filed off a long time ago.
Yeah, I imagine so.
It can't be pawned.
Nice.
My word of the week.
My word of the week is penny. So I chose this word because me and Tom, last week, we were looking at pre-decimalized currency in Britain. We were quite amused at learning about the pre-decimalization of the British currency. Before 1971, our system was not divided into tens and hundreds. 100 pennies did not equal a pound. Far from it, you actually needed 240 pennies. We had wonderful things called shillings that sort of were in the middle. And it's very interesting because there's lots of slang that comes with these coins. So maybe, Tom, you can tell me some slang that we currently have for British money.
Well, I know one to do with penny.
Okay.
Which is to spend a penny. I know another one, which is quid. That's a very famous one. So quid means a pound. So 10 quid, 5 quid.
Mm-hmm. Other things like fivers, tenners. Mm-hmm. But going back 50 years or 60, 70 years, sorry, we had a lot more slang terms.
Right.
So I'm going to talk you through some of these. I think they're amazing. So a penny could actually be divided. And we had something called a farthing, which was a quarter penny. Then we had a halfpenny, which was a half penny. Then, because everything was done in 12s, 3 and 6 was very important in the system. So 3 pennies was a threepence, 6 pennies was a sixpence or a tanner, 12 pennies was a shilling, also called a bob.
I've heard of shillings.
And yet, you needed 20 shillings to get a pound.
Okay.
So what that means is you needed 240 pennies.
Right, makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't, but it makes sense.
But it's quite interesting. So the word pound, because obviously penny and pound have always been related. Mm-hmm. So the penny actually comes from, it was a pound of silver that if you divided it into 240 parts, that literal weight of silver was a penny. And then they would mint, and then it would become a legal tender coin.
Mm.
But yeah, very interesting. Another thing.
So that's a really interesting word, is mint. So to mint is to create a coin, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that must be where we get the phrase, or the word minted. So if someone is really rich, you can say they're minted.
Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to ask you if you knew what a groat was.
I've never heard of a groat.
So a groat, this was slang for 4 pennies.
Right. So why does there need to be slang for 4 pennies?
Well, because, again, you know, most of the time you'd be being paid in pennies and shillings.
Mm-hmm.
And you would divide a shilling in 2s, 3s, 4s, and 6s.
Okay.
So 4 pennies is a third of a shilling. So that's why maybe it was more important.
Yeah, I see.
Because, for example, in America, you can still get a quarter.
Mm-hmm. Can't you get quarters and dimes.
Yeah.
Do you know the word for a coin collector?
Please. Please tell.
It's a numismatist.
Numismatist.
Okay. My word of the week is numismatist.
My artifact.
My artifact is the penny black. For 1 penny, you could send anything around the United Kingdom that was under 1/2 ounce.
Okay.
So yeah, it was actually very expensive to send letters before the penny black, because basically what happened was when you sent a letter, it arrived at the local post office. You would then have to go to the post office and pay a fee to collect your post.
Right.
And the problem with this, so often people wouldn't even collect their post.
Oh, right.
Someone would send a letter or post and people, they wouldn't want to pay the fee. But this changed everything. It was prepaid postage. And I wanted to tell you maybe a bit more about the history of the postal service.
Yes, please.
So before we know it today with stamps, you needed really to trust the messenger. So often kings and queens have actually decided that they should have control over the whole postal system. So Queen Elizabeth I, she actually said that all letters could be open and read, and that they had to go through official channels.
Right. Was this a kind of early form of an intelligence agency then?
Well, yes. I mean, letters, they actually, it's really interesting. Letters used to be designed with sort of locks in them. So if you didn't know how to open it, or you would make it in a way that would show to the recipient that it had been tampered with, and therefore this highly secretive information had been compromised.
Right.
I think a famous example is Mary, Queen of Scots, would often use very highly secretive letters, and I think this was found, for example, by Queen Elizabeth I, and this was one reason that led her to execute you know, someone who maybe presented a threat to the English crown.
Right. That's interesting.
And one other interesting thing is they introduced, after the penny black, something called a tuppenny blue. What do you think a Tuppany blue was?
Tuppany blue. Well, it sounds like a different kind of stamp, but yeah. Why would you need a stamp that was twice as expensive? Was it like a first class stamp, one that was sent with more urgency?
Good guess. And I'm now curious when they introduced first class, second class, economy class to stamps, because that is the system we have now. But it was to do with weight. So again, it's incredible that for one penny you could send a letter anywhere in the kingdom. But a tuppenny blue was just a bigger weight allowance.
Right. Okay.
So a penny black allowed you to do half an ounce worth of letter, and a tuppenny blue allowed you to send an ounce.
Okay. I think it's interesting. A lot of, it's not that interesting.
go on.
I think it's interesting that a lot of people complain about the price of postage in the UK these days, but I still think it's very cheap. You can still send a letter to anywhere in the country for just a few pence.
Well, that's all we have time for this week. Thanks for listening. Please do follow the link to the website where you can vote for the winner of this week's Curiosity Contest. You can also find extra materials for this episode and a whole lot more. On the website, you will be able to sign up for lessons with me or Nathan, and that includes small group classes, private tuition, and our courses. Also, join the Discord community for topical discussions, games, and social events. Village Green English. Everyday British English. British English every day.